Draw something. Draw something cool. I think it probably fades away too fast.
Oeps, moet ik hem even stoppen?
Mag ik op die cirkel duwen?
Ach, jullie tijd waren dan bonussen.
Now, Jimmy, we're here with just one element of the JBL VTX V20 series line array. Now, just one element in our studio, not a great listening test.
Oh, I like how it sounds.
Yeah, okay. And how do we know how we like how it sounds?
Oh, because we did this.
Okay, so just to prove the point that we did in fact come and listen to the VTX in an environment outside of the CX TV studio, I'm here at the Big Top at Luna Park, Sydney. Behind me is six per side elements of VTX 20 and three S25 subs running in a flown cardioid configuration. So that's what we listened to. Here's what we thought.
I think I was really quite pleasantly surprised by this. Now, they have really changed quite a lot about particularly the way the high-end functions in JBL. So some of you out there might be familiar with what's known as the JBL bark, something personally I've never been a particularly good fan of. It's gone. The high-end of this particular series is actually quite different from anything I've heard from JBL before in a very positive way. It's a lot flatter, it's a lot more even. Imaging was incredible, particularly in some of the recordings we were listening to last night. So I think they're very positive changes.
Yeah, it was, actually.
Yeah, particularly when they played some, particularly some Broadway musicals, I felt like I was actually looking at the stage and I could identify performers. So that's really quite different from what I've come to expect from JBL. How about you, Jimmy?
Yeah, look, for me, I think they've got everything about this from 100 hertz upwards right. I'm still not sold on the flown sub configuration, but I don't think I'd be the only person out there who prefers a ground coupled system.
Yeah, that's
system.
A completely different ballgame.
I think, you know, and just without that, you struggle to get the real low end extension. But look, certainly, I think as far as the V20 goes, I agree. I think what they've done, they've got the D2 driver in here, which is the dual voice coil, dual diaphragm.
Yeah, now what is that all about? They've actually brought in some engineering experience from outside the company, shall we say.
Yeah.
This is really quite a radical concept.
Essentially what they've done is they've punched a hole through the diaphragm.
It's kind of like
a donut.
Sounds
weird. Yeah, it's like a donut, but it's also, when you do that, you take a whole chunk of mass out, and thus you reduce the inertia of the diaphragm, which means you can move it faster, which means you get better high frequency extension with reduced breakup modes.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was hearing.
Better high end.
Yeah, it was a completely different, better high end. I mean, if you've ever been skeptical about JBL, you need to get in front of this and hear it.
Yeah, and look, we were listening to it in a pretty solid configuration. You can run this in two-way passive mode. We were listening to it in full active, which the whole system was being driven off Crown VRACs, which is what it's designed for. You can get a triple two-channel amp VRAC or a triple four-channel amp VRAC. And the idea is that off one of those four-channel amps, you can hang up to three of the V20s. So that gives you nine elements per VRAC. In full active mode, you've got one amp channel for 110, one amp channel for the other 10, one amp channel for the mid, and one amp channel for the D2 high-frequency driver.
Now, the driver's not the only thing they've sort of rejigged and thought about quite a lot. The rigging options are really quite different from the old
Vertec. Yeah, look, if you're familiar with Vertec, you'll know there was one way to put it together. This has obviously still maintained the ability to build it, you know, in the train sort of format and rigidly lock all the angles between boxes together and then just pick it up. But what you can also do now with this, V20 has the option for compression rigging. So essentially you push the little lever out, you dial up whatever angles you want between the boxes, you push the red pin in, it locks the angles, your pins go in the side to lock your boxes together, and then you pick it up by the front end, and then you pick it up at the back end and either compress it to the original pick point, or you can compress it off a second motor, and then you can tilt the whole array back and forth, and you've even got a little slot here where you can put the laser in, figure out and exactly where your aim is going.
It means on the way out, you can actually drop it flat, drop it onto its dollies, take it off as you go, and just wheel it out.
I think it's safe to say this one goes up and down faster than Vertec.
Yeah, I think it does. So, look, overall, I'd say get in front of it, give it a listen. It's really quite radically different from what JBL have done before, and I think in a good way.
Yeah, it's definitely not what you expect, and it's definitely a step forward.
Synopsys Core 250i Open Architecture DSP Processor. It's a really, really powerful unit with a pretty amazing amount of connectivity.
It's a real mouthful of a name.
It is difficult.
And yeah, look, I mean, that's, I guess, sort of indicative, as you say. It is a really powerful product, and there's a bunch of different stuff you can do on this.
Yeah, I mean, it's really only limited by your imagination and, I guess, the problem at hand that you're solving with it.
Yeah, look, I mean, you could use this to control distributed audio in a mm-hmm. bar or a club or a venue, mm-hmm. or you could use it to do echo cancellation and conferencing. Mm-hmm. The whole thing about the open architecture, and I think we should explain this for everyone, is that basically on the back of the unit, there are 8 card slots, and each mm-hmm. of those card slots can carry 4 channels of audio in or out of the core. Mm-hmm. Audio cards you can put in there include either a mic line input card, there's a high performance mic line input card as well, a line output, and there's a data port output card as well. Mm. So you can configure the slots to be any array of inputs or outputs up to a total of 32 of one or the other, or 50-50 split, however you like. And once you feed those signals in, basically they get digitized. You can control the gain on the mic preamps and phantom power and things like that, obviously. But then whatever you do with them is it's like you draw a signal flow map and mm-hmm. you route things by drawing lines from boxes to other boxes. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's great. I think the really unique thing to me with this unit is some of the connectivity on the back. There are 4 USB ports. It's not really very common on open architecture DSP, and you can actually connect external USB drives and stream audio into it.
Or you can load audio actually into the core. Mm. And that's not the only thing that stores on the core. What I really do like about this is obviously there are additional accessories. There's extra I/O, and that mm-hmm. that connects via the QLAN protocol, which is basically gigabit Ethernet. Mm. There are a set sort of list of switches that's been tested through, but any decent switch is probably going to do the job. Mm. And you can run an additional 64 channels of audio to or from, or a combination of to and from, up to a total of 64 channels into the core. And you can pick those from up to 1,024 on the network. Mm. Now, the really cool bit for me is that when you configure this, you do it with a laptop, and you can have touch screens with backgrounds and things like that, and the whole configuration, all the names, get stored into the core. So you basically upload the configuration, tell it to run, and it doesn't matter if you have a Stegosaurus walk on your laptop the next day, you can still go out, buy a new laptop, download the core designer software, and access the configuration in its entirety. You're not going to lose graphics and things like that.
Yeah, look, that's a common problem, especially with early open architecture DSP. Unless you actually had the same program running on your computer, you could not get the structure out of it. So that's a huge advantage.
And control systems in general.
Yeah, exactly.
Whether it's automation or lighting, whatever. Mm. And the other thing I really like is that you can access it through a LAN connection. Mm. You control it via LAN. There's another piece of software which allows you to manage the cores and name them and things like that. And you don't even really need to know how to set an IP.
Really?
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
It manages to be self-discovering on the network. Right. So the actual IT side of it's very nice. It's been well thought out, and it's sort of self-managing. I think that's very clever.
Yeah, that's great. So Jimmy, the front panel, it's very, very basic. There's only 2 buttons on the front. I've pushed them and they don't seem to do anything. When this goes into an install, how do you set up control?
Well, they do stuff. They change diagnostic information on the display, but that's about it. How you set up control is really gonna depend on the application. Mm. If you wanna have very full control, then obviously you'd leave a computer in there with either designer software, or you can build these what's called UCIs, which is, I think it's user customizable interfaces or something like that. And you can access these UCIs through a UCI viewer software. It is PC only, but hey. Mm-hmm. You can also access them through an iPad. There is a QSC app, which you download, which is a free download. And then as long as your iPad is on the same Wi-Fi network, you can then access the UCIs, and you can set up permissioning on things like that as well. So you can basically give people as much or as little control as the situation dictates.
Okay, and I would assume through the LAN port and the RS-422 compatible with AMX and Crestron control?
Yeah, look, there is probably serial, or actually no, you can do serial or LAN control. it does rely on having a bit of knowledge on how to write a thing called Lua code, which I didn't really get into. But yes, it is definitely possible.
Excellent.
So freely customizable and pretty much do anything you want.
Yeah, and very, very powerful. I believe you put a test design into this and didn't even get close to...
4%.
Wow.
Yeah. And that was for a real situation.
Okay.
In a real venue.
That's fantastic.
So there you go. QSIS.